little out of shape, but I hate to have somebody hit me out of the line. Wow, he might have put me in grave, you know. But what I want to share with you guys is something that has affected my life, and so I want us to get into it. I want you to turn with me to the book of Psalms. You know, I turned down the water a while ago. Somebody bring me one for you. Thank you, Mike. Thank you. Did I tell you where to go?
Psalms
18. Now, after that, I want you to find something I rarely teach out of the Song of Solomon. Rarely do I find stuff in there for me personally to preach on. Oops, watch me. I'm used to an earpiece, sorry. I'll get it. But I want to share with you something that I feel like every one of us as children of God need a revelation of. How many feel like you need a revelation of something?
Amen.
Now what I mean by this is a revelation is not just that you heard something, but it becomes a reality to you. That you really know that you have this down on the inside of you.
Yes. Yeah.
And I found out in life that you and I, we're going to go through temptations, we're going to go through trials that are brought upon us by the devil, by the world circumstances, difficulties that are going to try to do their best to bring you down. And what I found out through the trials of life, and I'm at the right church, anybody ever gone through a trial?
Amen.
Yes, sir.
What I've found out is that every one of these things are designed by the devil to make us feel less than.
Yeah, that's
right. Okay, from the end like that?
Yeah.
What's to make you feel less than? Now, if it's pride that you have in life, has anybody besides me ever had to deal with pride? See, no matter what you look like, no matter what's going on, you know, we all have to deal with pride, don't we? Some way, somehow.
Sure.
It creeps in.
Sure.
We're tired, we're good with our voice, we're good at the piano, you know, we're good at this, we're good at that, and all of a sudden, you know, we have to deal with that, right?
Right.
But less than what I'm talking about is less than who we are in Christ.
Amen.
Every trial that you're going to ever face in life, the purpose behind that is to make you feel less than what God said about you, so that you are not affecting people around you.
Right.
So that you're not living the kind of life that you really need to live, and it's because you feel less than.
Amen.
And I don't know about you, but I've had some things hit me. In fact, over the last couple of years, I had some surprise attacks. And they were very personal attacks. And they were very hurtful attacks. And I found out, while going through this period of time, that it was designed to get me to step out of ministry.
Yeah, sure.
To get me to quit.
Yeah, come on.
Right.
But I don't have quit in me. I've never learned how.
Amen.
I remember, I know some of you were never had a Wall Street game, but I had a little bit in me. Okay, a couple of you then. All right. This, you're the one I've been waiting to preach for. But as a youngster, if you looked at me wrong, I just said, "Did you just look at me?" And so we got in fights. I won some, lost some. I remember the one I lost. Anything else? I used to be pretty. Somebody rearranged my face. I remember going in and after getting a beating one time, I was in the service. Worst one I ever got. I was in the service. Over in Vietnam, and I mean, this guy cleaned my clock. My face was so out of shape, it was like this. I had to try to put sunglasses on and bend the red frame through. But I've come to find out that what's really important is that we realize what the enemy is trying to do in our life, and realize that everything that's going on in your life is designed to bring you down to a position where you're less than. And I feel like sometimes we can get caught up in a facade, and we can try to live life like somebody else lives it.
Yeah.
Or to imitate somebody.
Right. No, be real.
And I just want you to be real today, because I'm just real.
Yeah.
And I know you're either going to like me or dislike me. And those are two options. Well, there could be. Eh. Right. But if you listen to me today, I think I can help you. Oh, that other message was going to be good too. My daughter was going to help me. And had a message Bible all ready to go up here. Oh, we were going live all night. But here we go. Here in this 18th Psalm, just to preface it, David was looking back on a time in which he'd just been through a great deliverance, in which God brought him out of a very, very dark time. Sometimes the dark times that we get into is like what I had to feel and find out is that you're just so thankful when God brings you through something.
Yes.
Thank God.
Yeah. So thankful.
Absolutely. Not at all, George.
Man, I just sit down, you know, I've had a few physical problems here and there, but very, very little. And when I sit down, I start thanking God for what he brought me through. It just made me start thinking about all the things he's done for me, how that I'm living a pretty good life.
Yeah.
Praise God. I'm going to be 69 this year.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
I'm still pretty.
Amen.
Got my wife to believe it. I preach around her all the time, so maybe she'll believe that, praise God. But David had just gone through some really tough time, and just praising God and thanking God for what he had brought him through.
Yes.
How that Saul had chased after him, tried to kill him, just wanted his life, you know, because he was a threat.
Right.
But David had made a commitment that he was not going to touch God's anointed.
Yeah.
And because of it, God delivered him.
Yes.
Amen.
Even when God's anointed had gone wrong.
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, oh, you can be God's anointed and go wrong.
Absolutely.
I mean, you can be the best of the best and just go bad.
Right.
But he refused to do anything towards Saul, and God came in with a mighty hand. So let's start reading here. Verse 1, I love thee. Is anybody in a hurry, by the way?
No.
I guess you can tell by the way I'm talking, I'm not. I will love thee, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my buckler and the horn of my salvation and my high tower. And I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from mine enemies, praise God.
Hallelujah.
So shall I be saved from my enemies.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Well, do me a favor. Raise your hands right now. Thank God for being here.
Thank you, Lord, for everything.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord.
God. Hallelujah.
Now,
thank you, Lord.
In verse 4, he begins to talk about the dark times he went through and how so many were sent against him to destroy his life and even kill him. In verse 4, he says, the sorrows of death compassed me. The floods of ungodly men made me afraid. The sorrows of hell compassed me about. The snares of death, they prevented me. He began to tell about having problems and threat upon his life. Everywhere he went, it just seemed like boom, 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 boom. You ever felt like that? It's like everywhere you looked, there was an enemy. There was a problem. There was a difficulty. There was a trial. Just wherever you looked. And because David refused to go against Saul, though, God came in, and he began to move through David's life. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And David begins to share how God came through for him. Now look at this. Look at verse 6. In my distress, I called upon the Lord and cried unto my God, and he heard my voice out of his temple. And My cry came before him, even into his ears. Then the earth shook and trembled. The foundations also of the hills moved and were shaken, because he was wrong. There went up a smoke out of his nostrils and a fire out of his mouth. Devoured coals were kindled by it. He bowed the heavens also and came down. Darkness was under his feet, and he rode upon a cherub and did fly. Yea, he did fly upon the wings of the wind. He made darkness his secret place, his pavilion round about him were dark waters and thick clouds of the skies. At the brightness of those before him, his thick clouds passed hailstones and coals of fire. The Lord also thundered in the heavens, and the highest gave his voice, hailstones and coals of fire. I don't know about you, but it sounded like God came on the scene.
Yeah.
Amen. And here David is recounting how that he was surrounded by problems. But God, oh, I love this, God came roaring out of heaven.
Yeah.
Come on.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. I like to sit and think about that once in a while.
Hallelujah.
David, a man of God, had a lot of faults. I can relate to him. Made a lot of mistakes. Amen.
Amen.
But God, in spite of those mistakes, came roaring out of heaven.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
And I want to tell you something. You haven't seen all that you're going to see in Pastor Warren yet. But I've had a prophecy given to me, as was very similar to Brother Larry, that my latter years are going to be greater than my former.
Come on.
Yeah.
And I feel like in these last days, God has taken me over to an anointing that's going to change people's lives.
Yeah. Yeah.
Come on.
I don't know what all it's going to be. He hasn't revealed it to me yet.
Come on.
But I do know that it's going to be sound scriptural word. It's going to come forth out of my mouth. It's going to set people free.
Yes.
Yep. It's going to help people.
Amen. Lord the Lord.
And what I'm asking for today is that if any of you have ever had a hurt by all these things pressing on, that you're healed today.
Amen.
That you're here healed spiritually, mentally, physically, financially, socially. Any way that you can think of, that you are healed.
Amen.
And set free.
Amen. Yes.
Praise God.
Yes.
Amen.
God.
Amen.
Praise God.
Linda,
we're going to get some seats on our side of the church. Sorry, I get sidetracked myself. Verse 16. Am I helping anybody at all?
Yes.
He sent from above. He took me. He drew me out of many waters. He delivered me from my strong enemy and from them which hated me, for they were too strong for me. They prevented me in the day of my calamity, but the Lord was my stay.
Hallelujah.
Now pay very close attention to this last verse, because this is where I'm basing my entire time here today.
Amen.
He brought me forth also into a large place. He delivered me. Why?
Because he delighted in me.
Now look at that. Look at that.
Hallelujah.
Why?
Delighted.
I'm not trying to have you say anything different. Well, what does it say there?
He delighted
in me.
Thank you, Lord.
So when the Lord revealed that to me when I was going through my tough times,
thank you, God.
It shook me to my core. That even if I had missed it, even if I had made mistakes, even if I had sinned, which I pretty well got that under control, that God delighted in me.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I want to tell you something. When you're going through some tough times, that's something you need to have a revelation from.
Jesus. Jesus. Come on, man.
You need to know.
Thank you, Jesus.
That even I told my church this, that stupid is an enemy in my house. It's been in my house for many years, and I've been trying to do my very best to make sure it's not there. For the Spanish folk, I'll say it for you, El Domo. Some of you about 2 o'clock now, you're awake. But this really hit me when I was going through this, and it's like I wasn't expecting this. I thought he was going to show me something I had to do, something I got to correct, something boy, this is wrong, Warren, you gotta fix this. You know, and I was in that mode, I was in fix mode. Anybody been in fix mode? I was looking at me, okay, if all this is happening, then something is wrong with Warren. I refuse to blame other people. Something's wrong with me. So I went in and I began to look at me, and I began to fix me. And man, I kept thinking something else is gonna come out. And the first thing he talks to me about, in order to get me to be calm and be able to go through this thing, was he pointed me to the scripture. Because he delighted in me, he delivered me.
Amen. Amen.
Yes. And it wasn't because of what I could figure out to do right. It was what I had to figure out what was his feeling towards me.
Yes.
Even when I may be wrong.
Yes.
I wonder I'm right.
Yes. Amen. Hallelujah.
He delights in me.
Yes.
All of us.
Hallelujah.
I know this doesn't mean as much to you, but I'm afraid there's just one person in here.
Thank you, God.
I touched one person, and this whole time together is worth it all.
Yes.
It's all worth it.
Yep.
It's all worth it.
It's a good word.
Because I've come to find out that God was treating me like I was the only one in the world.
Amen.
And he was telling me, I'm delighted in you. All right, you ready? If you study out that phrase, delighted in me, you'll find it means something very simple, very, very heart-stirring, very simple though. The phrase delighted in me also means that I am precious to him.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Now that's a little more soft-spoken, a little more personal. That's a good word.
Amen.
A little more personal. A little more personal.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'm precious to him. So there I am now on top, delighted, and now precious to him. David was delivered because he was precious to God.
Yeah.
He killed somebody, murdered somebody, got somebody murdered.
Yeah.
Has improper sexual relationships.
Yeah.
How many knows a lot of preachers preach that's not right?
Yeah.
Right.
But here we find out that God delighted in him and he was precious to him, even in spite of him. And so that's what I tell my church all the time. I'm so thankful that God loves me in spite of me.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Now, if you were living around my house, you'd understand that. Hallelujah. But the revelation I want you to leave here with this is what I want to just say this message really is all about. That no matter where you are in your spiritual growth as a newborn babe or you've been in this a long time, I want you to walk out of this with this revelation that you are precious to God.
Amen.
Yes.
You are precious to God.
Yes.
Yeah.
So say it with me.
I am precious to
God.
Come on, let's say it again.
I am precious to God.
How about doing it three times?
I'm precious to God. Lord.
I am precious.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father.
Wow.
Thank you, Lord.
I did something for you.
Thank you, Holy Spirit.
Oh, my. I'm precious to him. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Amen.
Now, let's look at Solomon. I did tell you to go there tonight. Solomon.
Yes.
I want you to see this as a scripture that has double reference. It has reference to Solomon speaking to his bride, but the double reference is the Lord Jesus speaking to his bride, the body of Christ. And I want you to focus on just a couple verses, but one in particular. And that's verse 6, chapter 7. Did I tell you that much?
Yeah.
Well, you guys should have been in the spirit of the movie. Chapter 7. Verse number 6, you ready?
Yep.
How fair and how pleasant art thou, O love, for delights. The Lord took me to there, and I'm rarely in the Song of Solomon.
Right.
And I begin to find out that there's three Hebrew words in this verse that are synonymous, and that is fair, pleasant, and delights. The word fair also means to be precious to him. In this position. The word pleasant also means pleasure. And I believe this is how Jesus sees you and I and how he feels about us. I believe we're precious to him.
Yep.
I believe that we are a pleasure to him.
Amen.
And this is how our Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, sees us.
Amen.
And cares about us.
Yes.
That he has great pleasure in us. And here's another one that I just love. He delights in his relationship with me.
Amen.
He delights in his relationship with
me. Amen. That's it.
Oh, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Jesus. You know, sometimes I found out there's simple truths that the body of Christ needs to know in order to have a revival. In order to have the glory of the church. Just some precious truths. And that's what I feel like the Lord told me to share with you today.
Thank you, Lord.
Just the precious truth.
Amen.
Verse 10. Now this one here is the bride of Solomon speaking to him. And it says, and I like this, I am my beloved's. Can't you see a woman do that? I am my beloved's. I mean,
I'm beloved.
That sucker loves me. And his desire is toward me.
Thank you, Lord.
What that means? It means that his desire is not on anyone else but me. I can walk into a room of thousands of women, and his eyes would tour the crowd and find me and focus on me.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, God.
His desire is for me.
Thank you.
That's the way I treat Linda.
Thank you, God.
The Hebrew meaning of this verse is, he runs after me with delight. Now listen to this. He chases me because I'm just so precious to him. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Yeah.
He chases us because, man, I'm precious to him. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
And the Lord said, do you realize that's me talking to you? I go, what? This is male hormones coming up. Huh? I'm not a precious thing, thank you. But I accepted that, and I began to see that my God and my Savior delights in me,
yes,
and that I'm precious to him.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
No matter what you go through in life, no matter what kind of problems come against you, no matter what kind of difficulties, no matter what enemy tries to come against you, always remember that God delights in you and you're precious to him.
Amen.
Always remember that. Because something about that revelation will kick into you, and all of a sudden when you felt like you had no strength, you'll find strength.
Amen.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden when there was no fight left in you, you'll find fight left in you.
Yes.
Amen.
I want you to know, my dear friends, the body of Christ is a warring machine.
Yes.
And the reason being is that we have an enemy who hates us,
yes,
who wants to destroy you, and would love to take you to hell with him, praise God.
Amen.
Amen. And so we need all the help we can get to make sure he doesn't tear us down and we don't lose what we have and that we begin to gain in the kingdom.
Amen.
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 Amen. Yep. Because, he's referred to, Jesus refers to him as a thief.
Yep. Yeah.
And so what he's trying to do is steal away from you who you are in him.
Right.
Amen.
Rob away from you from what God has given you.
Wow.
Not because you deserved it.
Right.
But because he just says, you're so precious. I'm just so delighted in you. I sent my son down here 2,000 years ago. Praise God. And he paid a great price for you. And he bore all your sins and all of your iniquities.
Yep.
And he took upon him everything on the
cross.
Right.
Thank you,
God.
Yes.
Everything.
Yes, he did.
And because he loves you so much, he paid that awesome price.
Mm-hmm.
And he's bestowed upon you relationship.
Yeah.
He's bestowed upon you sonship.
Yeah.
How do you say it? No. Daughtership? Because we don't want this to be a masculine thing. This is a mankind thing.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Somebody say it, I'm precious to God.
Precious to God.
Amen. Amen.
Am I helping anybody up?
Yes.
The problems and difficulties that we face in life are designed to bring us down to depression,
yep,
Has anybody ever had to fight depression besides me?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
To constantly thinking of ourselves as less than. You try to judge yourself according to somebody else.
Right.
And, you know, like if I had Larry Huggins or Pastor John around me all the time, I'd always be trying to, God, am I as good as him? Could I ever be like him or something like that, you know? And the Lord's taught me to take my eyes off of everybody.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Focus upon him.
Amen.
Because mankind can fail us.
Right.
But Jesus will never fail.
Never.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
I want you to leave with us today. I want you to know that Jesus is passionately in love with you.
Thank you, Lord.
In spite of you.
Thank you, God.
Hallelujah. In spite of you, Somebody say thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Turn to Isaiah 43. Is it okay if I keep you along?
Yeah.
It's just a Saturday. What the heck do we have to do on Saturday? Listen to the word of God.
Yeah.
Amen. And Gavin, while they're turning to Isaiah 43, I want you to show them up there a couple of verses. Show them 147, Psalms 147, 11. Somebody help her. She's got a new machine there. There we go. Beautiful. The Lord taketh pleasure in them. I want you to see that. The Lord taketh pleasure in them that fear him, or in other words, reverence him or honor him. And those that hope in his mercy. Raise your hand about you.
Amen. Yeah.
Well, the Lord has great pleasure in you.
Amen.
Now show them 149.4. 149.4 says, for the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He will beautify the meek with salvation.
Amen.
He takes pleasure in his people. Are you his people?
Yeah.
Thank God. We're his people, right?
Yeah.
Whatever we told last night, you stepped into, we stepped into his people.
Yes.
Right. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yep.
All right. I want you to look here at Isaiah verse 1. 43:1, it says, but now thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob, and he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee, I have called thee by thy name, thou art mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, and shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon you. Those are beautiful scriptures.
Yes.
Now I want you to get this. Isaiah had a revelation of something. He had a revelation of God's great delight in his people. And Isaiah's words were a message of pure mercy.
Yes.
Just pure mercy.
Yes.
They had been brought into captivity because of their own stupidity and foolishness.
Yeah.
And that's the reason why I'm one stupid out of my house. I don't want it to.
Yes, sir.
Why? Because I found that if I don't let stupid in my house, I don't go into captivity.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
Literally, I've had to, you know, when I was going through some things, I've had to have Linda preach at. Go around the house, you know, I'm from Missouri. And we Missourians can get that donkey look, you know. Yeah, mule look, you know, walking around muley. I think I was going to be nicknamed Muley for a while, you know. And she started preaching. Because she knew stupid had come in the house. She seen Muley. Amen. So she was fighting stupid because she just lived in my stupid house. Now some of you don't realize that, but she's a lot smarter than I ever thought about being. No comments. But here, the children of Israel, because of their own stupidity and their stubbornness, foolishness, they had been brought into captivity. But in the middle of that captivity and that stupidness, God sent a prophet to tell them, you belong to me, and I am for you.
Amen. I love that. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I told you, I got one person I'm preaching to. That's why the Lord put her right here in my face. Look in her face. I know it's you. Actually, she don't realize it, but I need to be preaching this all the time.
Thank you, Jesus.
Question for you now. Please let this be rhetorical. Don't raise your hands. Has anyone gone through any troubles or difficulties that you have maybe brought about because of your own foolishness? Don't raise your hand. Don't. We'll see. I don't want to know. I found out the less I know about people, the better it is. Because then I have to be looking for a message for you next Sunday in particular. Well, I've got good news for you. Now look at verse 2. I want to give you some good news. Paraphrasing myself. God may not always calm the waters. He may not always keep the floods from coming. And He may not put out all the fires. But what He does promise is I will walk with you through it all.
Yes.
Yeah. And this circumstance you're going through is not going to destroy you.
Right.
It's not going to burn you.
Amen.
It's not going to drown you. So walk on through it all.
Amen.
And I will be with you. And that's even if, I needed to hear this, even if you brought these problems on yourself,
you,
I'm going to walk through this thing with you.
Thank you.
And we're going to take stupid and throw it out of your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Come on, I know I've got to preach to you more than just me.
Yes. Amen.
Preach to me too. I receive it.
Amen.
Father, thank you that stupid is leaving our house right now. Amen.
Amen.
I know that sounds silly. I've never heard a preacher talk like that before. Well, maybe it's time we did, you know. It's like, geez. I think stupid has been buddies to a lot of Christians, you know. Like, hey, come to church with me. I feel like what God is saying to me at that time and to all of us right now, you're going to come out on the other side and you're going to find me right beside you.
Amen.
And I have never left you and I have never forsaken you.
Amen.
It may have looked bleak and it may have not been comfortable. But I was there with you and now you're on the other side.
Hallelujah.
Because I was with you.
Amen.
Not because you did something great, not because you did something right, not because you read the Bible more or anything like that, but because I was there by you all the way is why you're here on this other side now.
Amen.
Looking back and going, thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you. Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
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 I preach myself happy. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Remember those four boys? Or three boys? Four boys. I call them four because there's a fourth one. When they threw them in that fire that actually consumed the people that threw them in,
that's right.
There was a fourth man in that fire.
Right.
The Bible says it seemed as though he looked at like the Son of God. Well, guess what?
The Son of God.
The Son of God.
Yes, sir.
And I believe they went into that fire with the attitude, I will not bow, I will not give
that's
up.
Right. Amen.
And I am precious to God.
Amen.
My God loves me because I love Him.
Amen.
Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And here's another revelation that's beyond what I just said. God loves me whether I love Him or not.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
That's the greatest revelation I think
thank
any
God.
Of us can get.
Yes.
Because love is something that every one of us have to grow in. I'm growing in it. I got hold of faith right off the bat. No problem. Kenneth E. Hagin was the first faith man I heard preach. Somebody came to me and I didn't even know who he was. I never heard of him back in 1980. So he, you know, came knocking on the door. He went to our church and, you know, I just got turned on the Lord and excited about God and just changed my life just day and night.
Yeah.
I mean, day and night difference happened overnight. I really got one again. And he came in and gave me this book, you know, big blue book. You remember those study books that Brother Hagin had?
Yeah.
Does he still have them?
Yes.
Yeah. He had like the Holy Spirit one, the prayer one. And the one he gave me was the one on faith, the study book on. And I got hold of that and I began to read, and I never had seen anything like that in my life. I was always being told, thou shalt not, and you got to be a good boy. And this guy was talking stuff that was like, oh my God.
Come on.
I got turned on to faith.
Life.
Praise God. And it changed my life.
Wow.
But I didn't have a whole lot of thought, you know. That's something I had to grow in. I still, to this day, it's hard for me. I'm working on it. I'm very tall, I'm going to be 69. I figure by the time I'm 90 or so, I should have it. And I told my church I'm going to be preaching to the moment I die or he comes for me.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not going to quit.
Come on.
Eventually, I will not have a problem with hugging people. Now, you have me hug my wife? Man, that's up to that. Come here, Rachel. Nothing to do that. But hugging people? I don't know, I just never was. My dad never did. I don't remember dad pulling me up on a slant knee or anything like that. I don't remember being up by it. Back upside the head or something. I'm telling you, boy, you're going to do it again. And so I still have problems here, 69 years old. And sometimes I have to go into a service and I say, I know people are going to hug me and I got to make sure that I hug them back and actually mean it. Because generally I see somebody, you know, who just loves a hug. We heard about it last night from And I see them and here's what I see. Arms wide, big arms, like a tree. And this big pair of lips is not like this. I think I'm just coming. And so if you ever see me just sort of reach over and do like this, it doesn't mean I love you, it's just like, get away. That's all. It just means get away, it doesn't mean I don't love you. So, as a pastor, I'm still learning. Anybody else learn anything?
Yeah. Thank you, Lord.
Now listen to this. This is important. I believe God's motivation for desiring to deliver us is not because we increase our prayer time. It's not because we increase our reading time. It's not because we increase our study time. Or even that we may promise God, we'll never fail you again.
Sure. Oh, yeah. Right.
Please, that's stupid in your house. Okay. But I believe there's motivation for wanting to help you and I. How many would like to have some help?
Sure. Amen.
Would like to have some help? Amen. I believe there's motivation, no matter what we're going through, and maybe no matter what you have done, maybe wrong even, is that we're precious to us.
Right.
Amen.
I'm precious.
Good.
Look at verse 4. Since thou wast precious in my sight, thou hast been honorable, and I have loved thee. Therefore will I give men for thee.
Amen.
And people for your wife.
So.
Fear not, for I am with you. Oh, that's a promise.
Amen.
Everybody say, oh, that's a promise.
Yes.
Oh,
that's
a promise.
Yes.
That is a promise.
Well, thank you, God.
Now, I'm with you. Have you ever felt like nobody was there?
Yeah.
See, I've had preachers preach in the past, and I don't believe them. But they said, well, God placed you there for that. Teach you something. Nah. Nah, not by God. No. But he was there with me.
Amen.
Sure.
And he helped me get out of that.
Yes.
He helped me get out of that.
Absolutely.
How many of you ever felt sorry for yourself?
No.
Nobody knows. Nobody cares.
Right.
Even if nobody else in this earth does, because you see, nobody else knows what I go through. You guys don't know it. They're in Onion City. So they're in Onion City. I'll pay more attention to them than you realize. They're not thinking about me. They don't know anything about me in Onion City. I'm just, a few times in my life I've driven through Onion City. Just about 2 years ago, I was going down the bridge.
He was wrong.
Somebody was peeling
the
river. Yeah.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
was given to a people who had been robbed, they had been spoiled, they had been cast in prison because of their own foolishness and because of their own unbelief. This word that God was giving them was not because they corrected everything. But in spite of their failures, in spite of their unbelief, God came to them with a prophet and said, I'm going to deliver you because you are precious to me.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah. And I'm going to tell you, ever since this last one I went through, I've gone through a few. This last one, I will never walk away from him because I know no matter what I do wrong, he'll never leave me.
Amen.
He'll never forsake me.
Amen.
I will never walk away from God.
Thank you, Lord.
He sticks closer than a brother to
everything.
Yes. Yes.
My wife knows that I have fallen in love with her. I don't think when I married her I even knew what love was. Somewhat. She had good looking legs. And she told me, we're either going to get married in June or December. So I said, December. That was the last choice I had. So I said, well,
December what?
And I really didn't know what love was, but here's what I want you to get about my wife. My wife has learned how to become a wife.
Right.
She has learned how to love me in spite of me.
Yeah.
And I'm crazy about her. Mm-hmm. Never thought I could fall in love with anybody like that. I want to tell you something. I want you to get this. This is very important for your life. I've fallen in love with Jesus more than I have her. Yeah. She said it.
Amen.
She knows it.
Amen.
She's okay with it.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
She's all about you.
The best way.
Because she says, neither me nor on you, you're second to him too.
Amen.
But my beloved desires me. Turn to Numbers 14. Does anybody get anything out of this yet?
Yeah.
I hope I'm helping somebody by this rapidly.
Yeah.
Gabby, show them Proverbs 6:26. I'm going to get something out of this. You're probably wondering, what the heck? Look at this verse up there. Got it? This is away from the subject matter, isn't it? Seems like. For by means of a whorish woman, a man is brought to a piece of bread, and the adulteress will hunt for the precious life. Now, the first one threw me off when I felt that over there. I got, okay, now, why are you taking me here? I don't have this problem here. But then he wanted to show me something. The adulteress will hunt for the precious life. And he began to share with me about double reference again. The adulteress here is in reference to Satan. And here it says, Satan goes after those who are what? Precious to God.
Right. Amen.
So my question to you is, do you love Jesus?
Amen.
Yes. Over here on this side.
Yes.
Over here on this side.
Yes.
Here in the center.
Absolutely.
Over here.
Yes.
Everybody love Jesus?
Yes.
I've got some good news for you. Satan's after you.
Yeah. I see.
Well, praise God.
But, everybody say but.
But.
According to the scriptures.
According to the scriptures.
That we've already read.
Yeah.
We've already read. We don't have to be in fear.
Right.
Because the devil's after us. We don't have to be in fear.
Right.
We don't have to, oh my God, he's after me. He's after me.
Right.
Have you ever heard the testimony? I remember a real religious lady doing this. Came into church and said, oh, talking about giving a testimony. It's a testimony. I'm sure glad I made it this time. I didn't think I was going to make it. The devil's been chasing me all day, bless his holy name. Could have been a policy. But people are caught up with the fact that the devil's chasing us. Get out of that.
Right. Amen.
You can be guaranteed the devil is after you. He would love that every ministry that's in here, he just love to snuff you out.
Yep.
He would love to. But we don't have to fear that.
Amen.
Because we've been given, and thanks to Kenneth E. Hagin, Wigglesworth, and others before them, all the way back to King Jesus, that he's given us the word to protect us and keep us.
Amen.
Amen.
Yep.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He's after you. Why don't you wake up? Find out you're precious to God. And stop letting him chase you.
That's right.
And turn around and eat his tail.
Amen.
Throw the word on him. Slap you. Every time you walk in your house and you feel like you're less than, slap him with the word.
Yeah.
Throw something on him that'll make his brain go tilt.
Amen.
Just, he'll give his bicycle a jerk.
Come on.
But according to the scriptures, we don't have to think about this fear. Because God is always with us. And he's always going to deliver us.
Amen.
So what I'm going to encourage you to do today is just stand in faith.
Amen.
Like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But we also need to stand in faith like somebody else. And I'm going to quit with this. Joshua and Caleb.
Yes.
Joshua and Caleb. When they were faced with impossible odds and even have their own people standing against them, they stood in faith.
Amen.
Amen.
And I like it. So let's read a lot of scripture. Ready?
Yeah.
We'll end it with a lot of scripture. Scripture's good. Amen?
Amen.
Without it, you're nothing.
Amen.
Verse 1. And all the congregation lifted up their voice and cried, and the people wept that night, and all the children of Israel murmured against Moses and against Aaron. And the whole congregation said unto them, would God that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would God we had died in the wilderness? And wherefore hath the Lord brought us unto this land to fall by the sword, that our wives, our children should be a prey? Were it not better for us to return to Egypt? And they said one to another, let us make a captain and let us return to Egypt. Can you imagine a bunch of unbelievers like that in your church? Look at verse 6. And Joshua the son of Nun and Caleb the son of Jephunneh, which were of them that searched the land, rent their clothes. And they spake unto all the company of the children of Israel, saying, the land which we possess, or excuse me, pass through to search it, is an exceeding good land. But if the Lord delighted us, I like to put a but in there, but if the Lord delighted us, and they knew that he did.
Yeah.
See, that had the revelation I'm giving you.
Yeah.
Right. The Lord delights in us. We're his people.
Amen. Yeah.
Precious to
him. Amen.
Yeah.
Yes. He said, if he delights in us, then he will bring us into this land. He will give it to us, a land which flows with milk and honey. Only rebel not ye against the Lord, neither fear ye the people of the land, for they are bread for us. Their defense is departed from them, and the Lord is with us. Fear them not.
Yes.
I believe you and I, we can put our names in there.
Amen.
I believe the Lord is with me.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen.
Say that.
I
let me give you something else. I do not fear the weapons formed against me.
I do not fear the weapons formed against me.
But I'm strong in the Lord and the power of his
might.
Because I'm precious to him.
He
will always
be with me and deliver me.
Always.
Always.
Not sometimes.
Not sometimes.
Not only when he feels like it. But always.
Always.
Not just when I'm good.
Not just when I'm good.
But even when I'm okay to town.
Okay.
Some of you are going, oh God, I can't say that. No matter what comes against me, no matter what comes against me, no matter what ever comes against me,
yeah.
No matter whatever comes against me, I think somebody else needs to say that. One more time.
No matter.
I said no matter. I don't hear. No matter.
No
matter.
Doesn't matter.
Right. Oh, it's too big for me. It's too strong for me. And the problem is, have you seen who's with
me? Hey.
Ha!
Great to see you.
Did you get anything out of this?
Yeah.
Great.
Well, do me a favor and stand up. I hope I help somebody. But that's really all I wanted. I don't strive for attention. In fact, if anybody knows me very well, they know that I'm glad to just sit over in the corner and be quiet and be still.
Amen.
I have people around. around me just talking, go, go, go. And they wonder if I have a word for them. Yes, be still and know that the Lord is. I'm an inward person. I'm always thinking about something. Always. I love to meditate on the word. I love to think about it. And so sometimes I'll be watching television or a movie with somebody and not even know what's in front of me, just going down on the inside of me. God trying to help me. Anybody besides me need help?
Yeah.
Does anybody besides me need help?
Yeah.
Yes. Here's what I want. I want to end this with a confession. Everybody ready?
Yes, sir.
Everybody say, I cannot fail.
I cannot fail.
I will say it again.
I will say it again.
I cannot fail.
I cannot fail.
I will never fail.
I will never fail.
I will never fail.
I will never fail.
All my enemies are meat for me.
Are meat for me.
Because I'm precious to the Lord.
Because I'm precious to the Lord.
And I say it again.
And I say it again.
I am so precious.
I am so precious.
To the Lord.
To the Lord.
He loves me.
He loves me.
He can hardly take his eyes off of me.
He can hardly take his eyes off
of me. I'm gorgeous in his sight.
I am gorgeous in his sight.
Some of you guys would have difficulty.
Hallelujah.
Hey.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Oh, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah. Are you thinking about these words?
Yes.
He delights in me.
He delights in me.
And I'm going through this trial.
I'm going through this trial.
And I'm coming out on the other side.
As a conqueror.
And living in victory.
Living in victory.
My joy restored.
My joy restored.
And I'm one happy word.
I'm one happy word.
Glory.
No trial,
no
difficulty in life is going to take me down.
Even if
I have brought on this trial all by myself. But
my outcome
will always be victory, because I am precious to the Lord.
I am pleasing in His sight.
No matter what you think,
my God's in love with me.
I don't understand it. I really don't.
Thank you, Lord.
But I'm so thankful. So the rest of your service looked settling down when I got to that point. You can't talk about yourself that way. I can't. I don't understand why He loves me. I don't.
Amen.
I have made some dumb mistakes in my life. But He still loves me.
Amen.
This all just blow your mind. When you were steeped in sin, you were Mr. Mrs. God sent Jesus just to get you back in His presence, where that one day He would just wear off on you and you begin to come like Him.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Did I help anybody today?
Yeah. Yeah.
Hallelujah. Or should I say this? Did the Holy Spirit help you today?
Yeah.
He did.
Because I'm telling you, this is only what I get. This is what I've decided in my church. I'm just not going to give you stuff. But I'm going to give you only what is for me.
Yeah.
And so if you feel like this message is for you, I'm telling you, just like I did my church. It was. But it was first for me.
Amen.
Was I thinking of you when I thought this missed? No. Not one person was in front of my eyes. Last night, about midnight, I was in my lazy boy. That's a good bedtime for me. The Lord dropped this into me. He began to talk to me about all this conversation. He said, Lord, I'll talk to me about something that is beginning to change your life. And He used the word beginning.
That's true.
Father, thank you for
your
Lord. The Spirit does
you. Thank you.
Thank you.
I want you to just in your own way right now to forget about anybody next to you. Don't feel inhibited. But I want you to raise your hands if you want to. If you want to. If you want, you don't have to. But in your own way, just start thanking God right now for His love.
Thank you.
Thank you. Just thank you. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the blood. Thank you, Lord, for the blood of Jesus. Thank you, 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 Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you
for your love. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.